Hello and welcome to another video. In this video, I'm going to talk about acquired immunity. Now, the immune system uses two main strategies to defeat any type of unwanted invaders. One of them is called the innate, and the other one is called acquired. So the innate immune system is mainly present since birth, and therefore sometimes also called the natural immune system. The acquired, however, forms during a person's lifetime, and is therefore sometimes also called adaptive. Now, please don't get this wrong, this baby also has some type of acquired immune system. I just put it there to show you that you've always had the innate immune system ever since you were born. Alright, so let's put this to practice. Imagine there are three different types of bacteria, right? The innate immune system is what we call non-specific because it's going to attack all of these three bacteria equally. It doesn't differentiate between them. The acquired, however, is going to attack these three microorganisms individually. And then upon defeating the microorganisms, you're going to gain some type of an immunological memory, which usually becomes enhanced upon repeated exposure to the same antigen. Alright, so let's see how the acquired immune system works. Now, there are two ways to divide the acquired immunity. You can either have an active immunity where your immune system is doing all the work, and we can have passive. That means when your immune system is not really active, and I'll show you why in a second. So let's start with the active. There are mainly two ways to initiate the active immune response. One of them is naturally, by getting infected with any type of microorganism. The other type is artificial, by injecting the inactive microorganism or the peptides of it. Either way, the reason why it's called active is because T lymphocytes is going to be involved, and they're going to help produce antibodies. And as a result from that, the active immune system is going to form an immunological memory. Passive, on the other hand, can also be classified as either natural or artificial. The artificial way is by actually injecting the antibodies into the patient. Usually when a person has been bitten by a snake, for example, injecting antibodies against their venom is a quick and effective treatment. The natural way, on the other hand, is by receiving antibodies from the mother through the placenta. So when this bacteria comes into our body, these antibodies received will go against that. But as soon as we use them up, we're going to go back to have no immunity or start activating the immune system. So that's why it's not active. That's because the immune system doesn't really thrive to kill the microorganism, because it already had the antibodies against it. It got lazy. So now let's go back to the active immunity and see how the adaptive immune response works. Now there are initially two ways the adaptive immune response works. Either it works with humoral factors, which usually involves antibodies coming from plasma cells when a T helper cell 2 helps B cells differentiate at the lymph node. I'll get more into that later. But the humoral immune response can work against bacteria. It's called antibacterial. It can work against viruses. So it's called antiviral. And it can also work against toxins. So we call that antitoxic. The second type of mechanism the adaptive immune system works with is against bacteria or viruses that hide inside our own cells. And these we call intracellular microorganisms. This type of mechanism is called cellular, and often involves T helper cell 1 helping T cell, the toxic cell, differentiate and get rid of these infected cells. Now, before I go detailed into these two topics, I need to go through the different type of antigens we can recognize, what MHC is and why it's important in adaptive immune response, and the different antibodies we have in our body. The reason is that, in my opinion and experience, you could say, I believe that if you really understand these three points, the antigens, major histocompatibility complex, and antibodies, you'll really understand much more of the adaptive immune response, and it'll become easier to understand the mechanism as well. That's why in this video I'll cover antigen and MHC, while antibodies will be a different video. Alright, so let's start with antigens. Antigens are the things that actually trigger your immune response, right? Which can bind to antibodies and other receptors on your cells. So it has to be foreign or something that's not you, right? So what could that be? It could be microorganisms like bacteria, fungi, virus, or even protozoa. It can also be red blood cells, for example. If you're a type A, meaning that you have A antigens on the surface of your red blood cells, and you give it to a type B person, that's a person who have B antigens on the surface of the antigens, but they have antibodies against A. And so that will cause an immunological reaction because their antibodies will bind to your red blood cells if they receive blood from you. Oncogenic cells can also be a target for your immune system, meaning cancerous cells mainly, and they can be differentiated by their MHC1 complex. The same goes to virus-infected cells. Toxins and venoms from animals and plants can also trigger our immune response. Even chemicals or complex structures can be an antigen. You know, on the surface of the bacteria, proteins can be an antigen. Proteins are actually the most immunogenic, meaning they easily induce an antibody production. Polysaccharides can be an antigen, and also lipoproteins, for example. And you know, what we find as dangerous might not be dangerous for animals, for example. The reason is our genetic buildup. So genes has a lot to do with what we perceive as antigens. Now, there are two words that are important to remember when it comes to antigens. The first one is immunogenicity, meaning the ability to cause an immune response. As I told you, proteins are very immunogenic because their ability to cause an immune response is very high. Another word is antigenicity, meaning the ability of an antigen to bind to the antibody. Now, our body doesn't just bind to the antigen, you know, whatever random place it grabs, it catches. It doesn't work like that. Each antigen has what we call epitopes. And epitopes are any part of an antigen that is recognized by the immune system. So one antigen can have different epitopes, right? Let's say this is an antigen, right? It's going to have three different epitopes on its surface where three different antibodies can bind to. This is what we call multivalent antigens with different epitopes on it. We can also have multivalent antigens with repeated epitopes on it where the same type of antibody binds to it. Now that's one type of classification. Another type is what we call continuous or linear epitopes, where we have a continuous amino acid sequence, which actually can be recognized by an antibody. And there are discontinuous or conformational epitopes, where, as you see here, are formed from different or several amino acids in a sequence. Antibodies combined, or even cells that has the right receptors to it, can also bind. Now, we do have a small classification system of antigens, which I've actually found pretty helpful. First, we can classify them by their immunogenicity. Either it can be a complete antigen, as you see right here, which can induce an immunological reaction. It has to be more than two epitopes on it. Or it could be an incomplete antigen, which can bind to the antibody, but nothing really happens because it's too weak, this antigen. The other type of classification is by their immune response, where it time is dependent, which means when an antigen-presenting cell activates T lymphocytes by presenting their antigen on an MHC class 2 molecule, as you see right here, the T cells later acts on B cells and then becomes plasma cells. The other type is thymus independent antigens, where B lymphocytes are practically activated without the help of T lymphocytes. So, you know, the B cell, right? It has already antibodies on the surface, either IgM or IgD. You'll see why when I talk about the development of the B lymphocytes in future videos. But some repeated carbohydrate antigen, for example, can activate the B lymphocyte without the help of T cells. Although if T lymphocyte is not included, this B lymphocyte can only differentiate into a mu type plasma cells, which secretes only IgM, and no immunological memory happens here since T cells were never involved. All right, I'll talk more about this later. But just to sum up, if it's a small antigen, there is a decreased immunogenicity, meaning a small chance of inducing an immune response in contrast to the big antigen. Also, the more complex the antigen is, higher immunogenicity, right? Also, if the antigen has many similarities to our own antigens, it will have decreased immunogenicity. In contrast, if it's completely different. So that was all I had for antigens. Now let's look at how the major histocompatibility complex or MHC works. You know, the antigen presenting cells and the T lymphocytes, they use these MHC molecules to differentiate one another and communicate. Now, MHC is found in all animals, right? And it's very different from one species to another. That's why in humans, we say human leukocyte antigens. But in humans, the MHC region occurs in chromosome 6. There's going to be a lot of genes, right? The MHC genes is found in the short arm of chromosome 6, right here approximately, around 200 genes going to code for a HLA molecule. Now, in the humans, we get three classes of major histocompatibility complexes. In class 1, the region or gene loci called HLA-A, HLA-B, and HLA-C make up the class 1 major histocompatibility complex. We got three from father and three from mother. So you can already get a hint that any variations of these six gene loci is what makes my organs different from your organs. And why do I say organs? That's because MHC class 1 is present in all nucleated cells in your body. And that's why it's much easier to receive red blood cells that don't have any nucleus, meaning no MHC class 1. Now, the MHC class 1 looks like this. It has an alpha chain composed of three domains. And for this, you can just imagine a thread forming three loops. You know alpha 1 and alpha 2 up there? They're going to be the binding site for MHC 1. That's where the peptide is going to be. And the last loop, alpha 3, is where the MHC is bound to the membrane. It's kind of anchored to the membrane. B2, however, it's encoded by chromosome 15, if I'm not mistaken. It's called B2 microglobulin. It's going to be constant, meaning it doesn't really change. Class 2, however, is encoded by HLA doctor, HLA DQ, HLA DP, and HLA DM. These four gene loci forms MHC2. MHC class 2 is mainly only going to be present on professional antigen presenting cells, and these are macrophages, dendritic cells, and B lymphocytes. It can conditionally be present on all cell types if it gets stimulated by interferon gamma, but don't worry about that. It's just some studies I found. I can put the link in the description if you want to. But please remember this, MHC1, all nucleated cells, MHC2, only antigen presenting cells, professional antigen presenting cells. These are macrophages, B cells, and specifically dendritic cells. All right? It has an alpha chains with two domains and beta chains with two domains. Alpha 1 and beta 1 is going to be the binding site for the peptide, and alpha 2 and beta 2 is both going to be anchored to the cell membrane. Class 3, however, it has a quite different role than class 1 and class 2. It's just the genes that code for it are among here. That's why we call it class 3. It codes for proteins of the complement system and also some cytokines like tumor necrotic factor alpha, but mainly complement proteins. And that's why we sometimes call it complement MHC. All right, so even though most of the complement proteins are made in the liver, some can actually also be made in the macrophages like C2, C4, and factor B. So now let's look at how class 1 and class 2 works. We'll start with class 1 MHC. MHC class 1, as I said, is present in all cells with nucleus, right? Now, what does it do? Why do I have it in all our nucleated cells? You know, the natural killer cells and the T cytotoxic cells? These two are able to recognize the MHC class 1 molecule. T cytotoxic cells can actually recognize the peptide on the surface by using its T cell receptor and the CD8. Natural killer cells, it cannot recognize the peptide, but it can recognize the amount of MHC class 1. And if this cell is infected, it's going to express less of the MHC class 1 and it's going to kill it. So these two cells are able to recognize sick cells from healthy cells. And what are the sick cells? Those are infected cells, those are cancer cells, and even transplanted cells, like cells that are not initially yours. So normally, all nucleated cells present their own peptide, right? Remember I said that natural killer cells cannot really recognize this peptide, can only recognize the amount of MHC class 1 molecule it has. So T cytotoxic cells binds its TCR receptor with the MHC class 1, and then it uses CD8 to dock to the MHC class 1, and then it says, yep, I recognize this cell, and then it goes away. Now, let's say this cell gets infected by any type of intracellular microorganism. It will then want to present its foreign peptide on the surface of MHC class 1. Now what happens? T cytotoxic cell binds. It says, nope, this is not our own cell. And what does it do? It releases perforins, which literally perforates the membrane of the cell, and then granzyme B, which fragments the nucleic acid. So that's why it's called T cytotoxic cells, because it works by killing infected cells that present the peptides of intracellular microorganisms, right? Alternatively, you know, as I said earlier, you know, natural killer cells, once it binds to the MHC class 1, it works as an inhibitory response for the cell. But if this cell is infected, it expresses less MHC class 1 molecules, which means less negative signals sent to the natural killer cell, which kind of stimulates the natural killer cells to actually kill this infected cell. Don't worry about this mechanism right now. I'll talk more about this later, as I said, when I talk about cytotoxic immunity. I just wanted to introduce these so that you kind of see the connection. Now, MHC class 2 molecules. You know an antigen-presenting cell? This is the dendritic cell right here. Imagine there's a bacteria right here. This cell is going to phagocytose it by reaching out their pseudopods and then forming a phagosome, and then which is going to fuse it with a lysosome, like this, forming a phagolysosome. It's going to fragment it and then form small peptides, and then it's going to present these small peptides on an MHC class 2 molecule. And then after that, it's going to travel to the lymph nodes, unless it's already there, or other secondary lymphoid organs, and present it to a naive T helper cell with its CD4 as support. And it's going to activate it and help it differentiate into either T helper cell 1, which activates macrophages and stuff, or T helper cell 2, which helps B cells differentiate. So that was MHC class 2. Now, just a quick little thing about something we call group antigens. You know the family Enterobacteriaceae? E. coli and Salmonella typhi both belong to that family, and both express their own peptides, but sometimes they can express the same type of antigen, and those are what we call group antigens. And these are gram-negative bacteria, right? And what they can have in common is what we call O antigen or lipopolysaccharides. Could be different virulence factors they could have in common. Those are V antigens. Could be a capsule even. Gram-negative bacteria can have capsules also, which work as in group antigens. These are called K antigens. Or even flagella. Those are called H antigens. Just think of hair antigens. So that was everything I had for now. I hope this was a little bit helpful. My next video is going to be about antibodies.